Hey guys, it's Dani. Today we are talking about dendrobiums. One of you guys suggested that I do make a video on all of the dendrobiums that I have outside. And we will take a look outside and see how I keep them, but we're not gonna actually film there because it's very, very noisy. There are some workers that have a project nearby, and one of them has this unearthly urge to whistle. He can't control it, so I think it's better for us to sit inside. But it's okay, I will show you all of these dendrobiums, and I do want to talk about how they've been this summer, how they're doing, my plans with them, how I intend to keep them over winter, and so on and so forth. So for the main part, the dendrobiums that I keep outside are the Phalaenopsis types, which you can see in bloom here, and also the Nobile types, which you can see in the back. They make up most of my dendrobium collection, but I do have some other types of dendrobiums outside as well, I'll show you. Most of them though are of this type. Now, if you are new to dendrobiums, I will share with you two tutorials, one for the Phalaenopsis types and one for the Nobile types, because even though I do keep them outside, they're very different between them. They require different cultural requirements as well, so it's not that they are the same and they have the same care, it's that I managed to find a segment in which they both need pretty much the same thing. The difference is the Phalaenopsis types, they're warm growers pretty much all year round. The warmer and sunnier you keep them, the better for them. The Nobile, on the other hand, they do benefit from a little chill down in the winter time, in which water and fertilizer is reduced, well, fertilizer is completely removed, followed by a blooming period. This regulates their growth pattern. They do have a pretty distinctive growth pattern, they don't grow all the time, and they can also grow off season if the chill doesn't happen. Which is not a good idea, because if they start to grow vegetatively in the winter time, when in many parts of the world days are shorter, temperatures are lower, they're just not gonna develop properly. But in the summertime, both of these dendrobiums are in vegetative growth, so I can safely keep them outside. They're heat tolerant, both of them, so they can absolutely sit even side by side on my terrace. So first let's start with the Phalaenopsis types. I have them all here, and you might notice that some look a little tinier, some quite large. Well, there are different varieties on the market. Some of them grow super, super tall even, some have very thick, very broad leaves, some tend to remain rather short and have narrower leaves. It's all variety based. Now, all of these love heat, and they are among the most heat tolerant orchids that I have. And not only that, they are among the most sun tolerant orchids I have as well, even more tolerant than Vandas, even without a proper adjusting to sunlight, let's say. Rarely do I have sunburn on these orchids. It happens, but not as often, I discovered. They don't require any type of winter rest or chill down or anything of the sorts. Furthermore, in the winter time, if there isn't enough light and heat, they will suffer. Mine were actually pretty set back. You might not be able to tell because they've picked up growth during the summer, but I know them and I can tell you that this is not their full potential. They can look even better than this, they can grow even taller than this. But last winter, I just didn't have a proper space in my grow room for them. I could not keep them outside, it was too cold for them, and they suffered from lack of light, primarily. This year, I will make sure to arrange a little artificial light place for them in the grow space, or maybe even on my southern wall, depends how I arrange things, because these orchids, I do not keep on the terrace in the winter. Just in the warm months, spring, summer, autumn, winter, no. So far, they bloomed for me once a year, but I have a funny suspicion they can actually bloom twice a year. But because I had that setback in the winter, I'm not entirely sure how their proper grow cycle will be in this climate. So this winter, I can tell you more about that and how they will perform in the winter as well. All I can say is that in not so bright light, a pretty moderate type of light, they really didn't grow as much as I would like them to grow. They're still okay, and I still have beautiful blooms, but I just know it's not full potential, and that bugs me. Also this year, I proceeded to repot them into an organic medium. More sphagnum moss in the mixture made sure that I didn't need to water them way too frequently. They do drink quite a bit of water, and especially in the summertime when water evaporates anyway, I do rely on sphagnum moss. Now, one thing you will hear about all dendrobiums, in pretty much all the articles, is that they like tiny pots. Well, it must mean that my dendrobiums are some sort of very special case because they hate small pots. They absolutely love big pots. And these are repotted about 2.5 months ago or 3 months ago. Oh, we have a buddy here, so don't get scared if you see him jump around. Returning to the pot size issue. I seem to not apply to that rule that states that dendrobiums will not be happy in big pots. I will elaborate on the pot size issue more in a different video, but I wanted to talk about it here because there is this idea that everybody spreads on the internet that dendrobiums should be potted in tiny pots, otherwise, I don't know, something bad will happen. Which is absolutely not true. Dendrobiums don't like small pots, they don't care about the pot. What they care about is the environment inside the pot. Yes, they really don't like to be suffocated because they're epiphytic. They also don't like to have bad or inadequate medium that will be either too dry, either too acidic, either too this, either too that. They don't like extremes. Pot size can influence the amount of time a pot stays wet. The smaller the pot, the less time it stays wet, theoretically or generally. It's not the case with everything. And that can be a good thing or a bad thing. For me personally, in this climate, and particularly because I do keep them outside in the heat, small pots are just a sure way to stress them out. Tried and trialed. So the best way for me to grow them is actually to use a big pot, which makes sure that the medium inside is adequately moist and airy at the same time, because I do make sure that my medium is airy. So just a little side note, dendrobiums don't like small pots, they don't care about the pot. What they care about is the environment in the pot. Pot size influences that environment, but you need to play with what's inside the pot, your particular conditions and environment, and their size, the root size, and so on and so forth. It's just not as simple as, ooh, dendrobiums hate big pots. No, they don't. They don't. Overall, I am pretty happy with their evolution outside. The downside is, I do believe my climate can get a little bit too chilly in the winter time. Even though it doesn't go below freezing, it's still kind of chilly. And I might try it out with one dendrobium. I asked you guys to give me a little bit of an advice when it comes to them and cold temperatures. Most of you who keep these orchids outside do have warmer temperatures than me in the winter, so I don't think I want to keep them outside. I might try with one and see how he does, but I think they will go back in the grow space once temperatures go down in December. I just need to create a pretty well-lit space. And hopefully things will be better than last winter, but I'll keep you up to date. So far, so good with my dendrobiums, but the winter, yeah, it's a no-go outside for me. With the Nobiles, things are a little bit different. These guys don't have continuous growth. It might seem that the new growths look similar to the other dendrobiums lengthwise, but actually the new growths you saw on the other dendrobiums started to grow in winter. So they've been growing for about a year. Not normal on those dendrobiums, but again, I didn't have enough light, so growths didn't develop normally, they sped up in the summertime. But these guys, the new growths, started in the spring right after they were done blooming, so these new growths needed to grow a lot faster than those ones. Hence, they needed more resources, and generally, Nobiles do drink more water in the summertime, they do need more fertilizer than the Phalaenopsis types. And because of this requirement, it was extra hard for me to maintain them happy in Leka. They did get dehydrated, they did have deficiencies, I absolutely didn't like it, so of course I repotted them this year as well. And I do believe they've been doing a lot better in the organic medium. Again, I potted it about 2 months ago, so they are freshly potted, but I can totally see a difference from when they weren't potted. Look at this. That shouldn't be on a new leaf. And how they look in the past few months. I do believe the transition was good. Speaking about the Nobiles, these types of orchids do lose their leaves, but not the fresh leaves. So, as you can see, this is a new cane. At some point, it will stop growing and the orchid will go through its, not dormancy, but cool phase, let's call it like that, during which buds will start to form along the canes. These dendrobiums don't produce flower spikes. Well, during this winter cool down, the fresh leaves will remain green, but the older leaves will fall. almost all of them, and in the end you will have quite a lot of bare canes, which in time you can cut, you can propagate. Not a good idea to cut them all the time, but when it gets a little bit too excessive, you can absolutely remove a few of them and try to propagate them. They can be propagated like that, they do create keikis. That's a whole different story. But on an old cane, you will have some really ugly looking like leaves at some point, which will yellow and fall. What's not normal is for the new leaves to have blemishes, to be yellow, or to fall. So when you have that, you know you have a problem, and typically it's related to hydration or fertilizer. So one of the two. I do believe in my case it was both. But they are actually doing much, much better now. With these guys, when you have a setback, it will take more to recover because they have such a strict, let's say, growth pattern. They typically grow one growth per year, break in the winter time, starting new growth in the springtime. Due to the fact that my summers are pretty extended, I sometimes get two growths per year. One of them doesn't get to mature until winter. So I wanted to keep them outside and see if this will regulate their growth, because putting them in the growth space sometimes makes them start a new growth in the winter or in the autumn, which is not ideal for them. It just means they will not allocate the energy properly for new growth, flowers, roots, all of those fun stuff. So far, so good. Most of them have not started new growth, so I think it's working, but I do want to play around with maintaining these dendrobiums outside all the time. They can tolerate chilly temperatures much better than the Phalaenopsis types. And yes, I will have probably flowers later on because flowers develop faster in warmer temperatures, but I'm much more interested in having a good pattern of growth, a, let's say, healthy pattern of growth, which will make sure that all new growths will have enough time and enough energy to properly develop. So with these guys, I do want to try out keeping them outside. They're extremely tolerant to low temperatures as long as it's not freezing. I'll keep an eye on the weather forecast. If I see freezing conditions, I will pull them in. That happens very, very, very rare. Not all winters have freezing conditions here in my climate, so I think I'm pretty safe to keep them outside, and that's what I shall do and see how they go. Another type of dendrobiums that I have outside are the fully deciduous dendrobiums. I don't have many of them. Here's the anosmum and the parisii. They're both species. And they're kind of similar to the nobiles, but before they start to bloom, they will actually lose almost, if not all, of their leaves. So all of the leaves created in 1 year, they will lose in the same growth year, not the same calendar year, but growth year, right before they bloom. So that's absolutely normal. And again, we are going to end up with some canes, which are bare. Sometimes the older canes can bloom. In my experience, they don't bloom all that much, because all of the eyes typically are already bloomed out, and once an eye already bloomed, it's not gonna bloom again. But again, not a good idea to cut away the canes unless they're excessive, case in which you can cut away a few of them, maybe try to propagate them as well. But these guys, I'm not sure what to do. Considering that I don't have too many of them and I cannot find them available all the time, I'm not sure if I want to experiment or risk. Theoretically, they do actually need a little bit of a chill down, but they're not as cold tolerant as the nobiles. At least this is my opinion on them. I didn't test it just yet. It might be that they are actually very, very cold tolerant, but in my research, nobody actually says you can keep them in such low conditions as nobiles. You pretty much need to go on the lower side of intermediate with them, but not lower than that. So I might put them in the greenhouse during winter time and then put them out again when temperatures get a little higher in the spring. But it's okay, I don't have a lot of them. So that's about it on the dendrobiums that I have outside. I think I do still have in my collection some dendrobiums which need a cool down. I'll go in my collection and see and put them outside to get a chill down, but I don't have many dendrobiums as it is in my collection. Most of them, as I was saying, are nobiles or Phalaenopsis types. So we'll see, I'll try to work on that, but I think I have other orchids which I want to have before more dendrobiums. And when it comes to dendrobiums, I do think I prefer a little bit more the Australian ones, the ones that look like the Kingianum, but they're not. Shape-wise, I mean. There are many, many Australian species that I really, really like. They're now very available here in Europe all the time, so we'll see about that. But yeah, they're just not on the priority list at the moment. And that's about it on the dendrobiums that I have growing outside. Thank you for suggesting. I hope you've enjoyed this video. These are my notes so far on them. These observations might change slightly, or I might add to them as time passes. So this winter I'll see what to do about the light for these guys and how the Nobiles will do outside, and next year I'm gonna tell you all about that. Until then though, thank you so much for watching, hope you have a great weekend, you know the drill, like or dislike this video below, subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As and other fun orchid subjects, and if you like to support the channel, do consider visiting the merch store down below. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time, bye!